Let's see, I got a tweet. And then we can begin. I'm curious about something on Handmade Network, so I'm taking a look real quick. Oh yeah, I stream to both of these projects both all the time. Interesting. Hey, it's all right. I'm just getting ready to start a little something. Technically 1 minute before 5 p.m. here. I'll start getting things prepared. Gotta migrate over the new string library at some point. Although, why did I comment that out? I don't know. We'll have to look into that too. Alright, it's technically start time, so let's see. First of all, does this build? What I'm doing right now, I'll catch everyone up. So the last thing I was working on Cipher Drive, and it's been a while, this was back in July, and I haven't really touched it since then, since I went on break. So I'm working on a TTF to bitmap system, and the way it's supposed to work is just to take a TTF file, render a bitmap rasterized version of the font in whatever settings we want, and make one single file that represents the entire atlas of the rasterized font, which I'm calling a BFT. And the reason we're doing this, it's not a part of the actual asset packer yet, but we have the system that handles assets, like the it's hard to describe. Let me just run the game. Oh. Let me think, how can I, there we go. If I run the game, what is it? F8 to pause. And if I hit F2, there we go. So there's my asset hierarchy. And you can see in here we have all kinds of different things, folders, a bunch of images are listed out here. And what we don't have is fonts. And the reason is I don't want to build a whole other type of system for a TTF. I don't want TTFs to actually be in my data folder anymore and to link up to assets like that. So what I want to do is I want to set up the official way a TTF file will be baked into before it gets baked into everything else, how it gets rasterized, I guess I should say, so that I can put the real TTF asset in here. Now, what I originally thought we might do was to render each glyph separately and put them in one big group. And I've decided that maybe was not the best idea because I need metadata for all those glyphs that I can't store in a bitmap, right? There's no easy way to correctly do that. I would have to make an adjusted version of a bitmap anyway. So I'm making it my own format that's just a rasterized bitmap format with all the information I need for placing characters correctly and for rendering them. And I'm using STB TTF for now as my font rasterizer, although I'll get fancier later on, is my assumption. Okay, so with that understanding in mind, the goal is to rasterize a TTF file. Does this build? We can close that. We probably won't run the game at all today. Okay, so yeah, the strings aren't recognized, which makes sense because I unincluded it. But why did I do that? That's crazy. Okay, well, either way, I want to update this file, so let me do that real quick. Because I've upgraded the string library a little bit, and I'd like to start making sure I can use the most up-to-date version of it here. There it is. Back to shmup. String. Alright. That should still build, I believe. What went wrong? Alright, so what we mean is cap. I renamed that function without realizing it. Remove extension. Let me see. String H. I have... Oh. It would appear that remove extension is something I've added here. Well, we can... deal with that real quick. Let me pop over to forcoder. Oh, it's fored is the name of the file. That's right. Alright. Internal string. File extension. We want remove extension. And I assume that needs to return a string. Remove extension. Oh, wait, no, that doesn't. That's not what that does. That's more like this one below it, not above it. Remove extension. And I pass in a stir. Okay, so it's going to be kind of like this, only we're not going to reverse seek a slash. We're going to, starting from the end, look for, yeah, starting from the end, we're looking for a dot. Okay. So all I want to run right now is metagen. Oops, these all need to be arrows. All right. Cool. So, if I copy that over again, and this is off screen, so just realize that. Sorry if it's boring. I'm just copying the file over from where it gets generated to where it exists and renaming it. Okay, now we need to go back to shmup code. I need to change this one back to that too. Alright, TTF. How do you look now? Okay, everything's back to working. We can remove that extension off that file. Now I need to update myself on where exactly I was here. So get files, what does this do? Source file name, get files result, source dest, successful open. I don't understand why it says files and not just file. Okay, anyway, I see. So this is getting the input file and the output file. I don't like those names. Oh, hey, there's more people here. Hi, insofar as Ginger Bill, let's see, Cryzy92, not sure what the correct one is there. And the first guy who I said hello to, I wasn't sure how to pronounce your name either, and I just guessed, and I just skipped it. I'm going to keep skipping it, because I'm not sure what it says. So I see digital. Was that Doofus? I don't know, maybe it is. Alright, so anyway, back to building stuff. Let's see. Oh, try that again. So, I was just about to go do a fork order to do, but I'll skip it. I already have it written down. Okay. So that's good. Let me keep reading what all this stuff does. So dump file almost certainly does what I always do when I call the function dump file. You put in a file handle and it outputs the all the data from that. Okay, so let's see. I wanna. What is this stuff? Did I just copy this from STP? Because I wanna avoid a mistake I made in the past. Let me delete this and start again. So the mistake I made before was I just followed. I just followed the STB TTF glyph data, and that's fine, like it works, but that locks you into STB in a way because now if you load any other person's data, you've got to make it match the STB data. Really, I think what would be better to do is define my own way I want the data to work, and then whoever I end up loading it with, I always have to do the work of figuring out how to match it to mine. But at least now I don't have to do the work of guessing at what their data is supposed to mean and how it acts. I know how my data is going to behave, so I just have to figure out how to interpret their data into mine, and I don't have to interpret from one unknown to another unknown, if that makes sense. So to render a glyph, I need to know. Well, what we're gonna do is we're gonna pack the entire font, all the characters that I think I'm gonna need, into a box. So I need to know for each character where the box begins and ends. For like where the character's box be where in the box to find it. So I'm gonna need like and once I've got that, I need to know how to position it correctly, right? Like I can't just take that box and draw it because then there's no line. Like if you're drawing fonts correctly, there's supposed to be this line here, but once in a while you have a character that wants to dip under it, and it like right here this P dips under it. So I don't just draw the P so that it's exactly, you know, got its bottom aligned to something or anything like that. I need to know how much offset in X and Y these things have. Now, do they have any offset in X? They may. Like if I say here's where the cursor is, draw this character, it may want to draw the character shifted over this way or this way a little bit. So I'm gonna have those should probably be signed actually, so that they can represent forward and backward shifting. And then finally, I need to know how much to advance after a character. Right? And then a font we composed of a set of those things and some extra data. I need to know basically if I have a cursor position, I want the top left corner to represent where I'm drawing the current text. That's how I'll set it up. So if I say here's where to put it, oh no, bottom, right? So I want the Y position to match this line here. That's what I think makes most sense, because that's the only spot where I can confirm that it's lining up where it's supposed to. I can draw a line there with pixels and see that it's hitting that correctly. Up here, it wouldn't be so easy to make such a test case. So along the bottom of Y, and I start with an X there, and then every time I write a character, I advance the X, and then when I need to drop down a line, I need to know how far to drop. So I need to know line height is what I'm saying. Let's see. Is there anything else I need about the whole font? I believe I can draw with this much information. Obviously, I need to set up the array of glyph data, like some data structure for putting in the code point and out getting the glyph that I want to draw. But that's a separate issue. So this is everything I need, I think, to render on inside the game. So I want to keep those separate from the extra stuff I put in the file, the bitmap font, the bpuffed file. There it is. Right. That will have some extra stuff to say, like here are the code points that we've got, and here's where you can find each one, and so on and so on. And I'll need to define that too. Now, init the font, scale for pixel height, get font V metrics. So far I've got, what, an ascent right here, font info, so I knitted the font here, so I have a good font info, and I knitted that from my source data. I'm right here, pixel height 16.f. Yeah, so that's fine. Now, font get font v metrics to store that. Okay, so what I want to do is I want to pull up STB TTF. So I can get some examples on how to do the rest of this. Init the font, get code point bitmap. Alright, so get code point bitmap involves putting in the font handle. Scale for pixel height. Okay, so they're getting the scale there and passing that right here. And then C, what is C? That's some weird, oh, okay, I see, that's not that. I thought this was all parenthesized, and I was like, that doesn't make any sense, but these two are print. Okay. So, if argc is greater than 1, then we use that size, otherwise A. Oh, that tells it what character to do. Okay, so you give it a character. Or something like that. Maybe you put in the number for the character you want. And then S. What is S here? This is the height of the font. So it's figuring out the scale. There's the code point it wants to use. Width, height. Okay, let's go see what that does. Get code point bitmap. X off, Y off, width height. Okay, so allocates a large enough single channel 8BPP bitmap and renders the specified character glyph at the specified scale into it with anti-aliasing. Large enough single channel 8BPP bitmap. All right. Zero is no coverage. Transparent. Zero. Oh, I see. So that's what it's talking about in the output of the. I was just going to return to me an allocated chunk. Yeah, let's go find more about this. Get code point bitmap. Bitmap subpixel. Get glyph bitmap. Pixel. Here's the real one. Okay. So the way it actually works is, what are we returning? GBM.pixels. GBM.pixels equals null. Yeah, malloc. Okay, so it's just allocating the pixels for me. Okay, so if that's the case, while we're here, let's do a few things for fun. Full screen. All right. Let's see. Crazy92, yeah, my path handling would break down with 9S games, but I'm not making a general tool here. I'm just trying to make something to convert the TTFs to my format, and once it's run, I can delete this code. Right, I'm the only one who's supposed to use this, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time figuring out how to make the paths work all over the place. Okay, so now that we've done that, we can go back to S to be a true type. Let's see. If it's gonna malloc, then that's fine. Kind of wish it would let me pass in a buffer or something. SQLY, shift X, shift Y. Oh well, I'll just mem copy, it doesn't matter. Do I have that set up? Yeah, I do. Okay, so with tie X off, Y off. So if I go back to get code point bitmap that calls the subpixel version with scale X and scale Y being forwarded through and the shifts being 0 and 0. Ah, because subpixel is for if I'm trying to render this like halfway between pixels. My screen is black? Whoa, one second. Let me see something. OBS right here shows me 4coder. Does anyone else not see it? Alright, tell me if it goes away in a second. Because it might. It's weird, it wasn't doing that yesterday as I understand when I was first implementing full screen. Wow. Alright, let me try something here. Yeah, now I can see it. OBS is just showing a black screen. It's wild. Why didn't that happen yesterday? Isn't that strange? So whenever I let it go into not unbordered mode, it turns black on the screen, on the stream. That's really weird. It's really weird. Alright. Well, we'll turn it off then. Odd. Okay, so I guess today OBS doesn't want to show my window when it's on top. Don't understand that at all. Moving on. When I do make glyph. Get code point bitmap. I see, get returns a bitmap, whereas make will render it into my buffer. Get code point bitmap. So it's setting the scale X to 0. Does that mean, so that goes to subpixel, that goes to make glyph. No. That goes to get subpixel right here. Get subpixel goes to, no, come on. Get code point subpixel. Get glyph bitmap subpixel. bitmap subpixel. There we go. And this glyph bitmap subpixel, it must do something about if scale x equals 0, scale x equals scale y. That way you can just pass it into y. I see. Okay, so now that I've answered all my questions, get code point bitmap box. Right, I just need to pass in the font info, get code point bitmap box. So there's my font. Let's see, here's my code point. Let's start with A. The scale I've got right here, IX, IY. Okay, can anyone explain to me that information? Get code point bitmap box. Get the B box of the bitmap centered around the glyph origin. So the bitmap width is IX1 minus IX0, the height is IY1 minus IY0, and location to place the bitmap top left is left side bearing times scale IY0. I see, so IY1 minus IY0 is the height, means Y0 is smaller, so it is Y increases down, so Y0 is the top and Y1 is the bottom, you subtract them, you get the height. Place the bitmap top left. IY0. So that's the location to place it. Left side bearing. Okay, so left side bearing is the X offset and IY0 is the Y offset. But why would I want my Y offset from the top? I want it from the bottom. This doesn't give me left side bearing either. I gotta find that somewhere else. Okay. So here we go. I need these four things. Boop boop. Alright, so I'm still missing some information here. I've got a box around it, and I know that Y0 represents Y0 somehow represents okay. Right, so what I want with my Y offset is if I'm telling it here's the line where to draw at, it's saying Y0, the value of Y0 is chosen so that if everyone's Y0 is the same, if everyone wants to draw at position Y, if I subtract Y0 on each of those, or in the case of Cipher Drive, actually add, because it's positive, goes up in our coordinate system. But yeah, okay, so this makes sense, I think. Now I just need to get left side bearing. Alright, so I pass in the font info, the code point of interest. Let me store that in a different way. Alright, and then advance width, left side bearing. What do those do? Left side bearing is the offset from the current horizontal position to the left edge of the character. Advance width is the offset from the current horizontal position to the next horizontal position. And these are unscaled. Okay, so what I have to do is I have to go advance left side like this, and then I have to fix both of these. So the advance is actually equal to maybe I want seal 32 on that one. Always hard to decide. So the advance will always be now. Let's try to round both of them. Right, so I'm going to round this. The problem is if I just truncate it directly, then it rounds to zero, but I want it to round to the nearest integer. So if I put in a zero here, it will add 0.5 and then round to zero. If I put in a negative 0.1, it'll minus 0.6 and round to 0. If I put in a negative 0.5, it'll become a negative 1 and it'll round to negative 1. Okay. I'm happy with that. Is Ginger Bill here? Ginger Bill? You here? If so, I have a language idea. Ah, Ginger Bill, you are here. So, here's an idea. You know how you've got like fancy casting and stuff like that? And this is something that I've always wished was just built into the language, because what I just did right now is something that I do frequently, which is I don't, you know, just like you, I don't really like to type int here or something to do the round. And you have like as right now, like as int and whatever. And I understand that like the built-in operation that converts a float to an int that's like built into the CPU is closer to, at least in theory, is closer to what happens by default, because it's just like floating point rules and stuff that it truncates by default. But writing these correctly, because like this up here is in theory kind of right, but like actually no, because like things will go wrong in edge cases if minus 0.5 doesn't happen to get all the way to the point it's supposed to, or it goes farther than it's supposed to because of a rounding error, and then it rounds wrong. So actually doing these right's kind of a pain, and if they were just built into the language, it would save time. So it'd be nice to have a way to say I'm casting to an integer and I want to ceiling, I want to floor, or I want to round, as other ways of how to cast to integer. Because when you cast to integer, there's all kinds of things you can possibly want there, and writing those by hand is just a pain. I don't know if that's a standard library thing or if they build it right into your casting notation, so just a thought. Anyway, let's see. Again, I'm not sh I'll you're probably behind me, so I'll let you catch up before I respond. It's not a completely fleshed out idea. I'm just saying, so it's something to think about. I don't know if you would build that into your rounding like your casting syntax, or if you would just do that as functions. The reason you might want to build it into the casting syntax is because at least I think of it as a cast. Like I think, all right, this is a float type, and I'm casting it to int, and I have to specify what kind of cast I want to do. If you just want to write those as procedures in a standard library later, that's fine too. But I'm just saying, since now you're still dealing with that kind of thing a lot, it'd be a good time if it was something you agreed with to do. But anyway, it's up to you. Just something I think about from time to time. Okay, so yeah, so I think I've got all the information we need on this code point, right? So we're using the code point A here. And x0, x1, y0, y1, advanced, and left side are going to pretty much correspond to these things. Now, they're not going to correspond to these x0, y0, x1, y1, because those are about where I'm packing my bitmap, not about where, like, the box is. So those won't match one to one, but x offset, y offset, and x advance will work. So let's grab those and set them up correctly. So basically, what's happening here is I'm setting up a glyph data, right, and I'm filling it out. So the glyphs, x advance is just advance, and technically, that's a cast. I guess I'm building in the assumption that advance is always to the right, and that might actually not be true if we were doing some really crazy stuff that we probably won't do, but that is theoretically possible in right to left languages. Okay. So I have my advance. Let's see, x offset, y offset. I can do those. X offset is the left side. right? And Y offset is Y zero because I'm using the bottom point there. I'm using the bottom line there. Give me a cursor. I'm using this bottom line here, and I'm if I understand correctly, it's telling me to use wait. Maybe y zero is already negative. Get code point box. Bitmap box. Technically, this could be negative, which means it's actually this that I want to do. Abner Coimbra, yes. This is the Cipher Drive stream. That's right. Okay. So what I want to do is I want to run this, and I want to see if these values look like what I would expect. So it's like, here's the thing. Space. Y off. Ba-da-do. Space. X off. Ba-da-do. Space. Advance. X advance. Glyph dot y offset, glyph dot x offset, glyph dot x advance. Oh, that's right, I switched that back to signed. What? Oh, I see. This needs to be a code point. So the error it actually meant to give me was insufficient number of arguments in printf. This nonsense about char39 was, dumb. Alright, so there we go. Let's see if I can run that. It doesn't run the thing. What am I building right now? Build tools. So Oh my goodness, I set this file up so that it wouldn't wrap on this monitor. That's awesome. Okay, that just threw me for a loop. Anyway, the more important thing is that, why do I have a dash there? Yeah, that's weird. I'm outputting something called TTF to BMP into meta. I see. So here's a question. Do I have a thing for running this? I do. Okay. So what I'm supposed to do... Well, first of all, there we go. TTF to BMP. Right. So let me go to the data, dir, TTF to BMP, liberationmono.ttf. Y offset is 9, X offset is 0, advance is 8. Now, if that's really a monospace font, if I put in an L, I'll get a very similar X advance. Yes. Now, suppose I were to switch over to Liberation Sans Regular. Now I have an X advance of 3. If I switch back over to A, X advance of 10. Alright, cool. So I'm getting something that looks like maybe what I want. Yeah, I see Ginger Bill and Albert Coimbra are bringing semicolon discussion into my chat, so I'll go ahead and let you guys know. I mean, I'm kind of the one who set off by being like, oh, I just decided that semicolons should always be typed, and it escalated from there. But here's the thing, is when I'm reading my code and like half the time I forget to use the semicolon and half the time I forget not to use the semicolon, it drives me crazy. So I decided I had to pick one. And as long as I tried for a really long time to not use semicolon, but I just once in a while would forget and use the semicolon. So I decided, no, I use semicolon always. And it was so much easier to get right. It's like punctuating your sentences. Alright, so, that's good. Now, what I actually need to do is, I need to find out which glyphs, which code points exist and which ones don't. So what we're actually going to do now is for loop, code point equals 0, code point less than or equal to 128 plus plus code point. I think that's the way I want to do it. Code point. What's the difference between that and using just the glyph version of these? Glyph bitmap box. Ah, so those work on glyph indexes. I don't want to do those because then I have to get the correct glyph index out of the TTF first. Okay, good. So, there's that. And I don't want to do this. What I actually want is more like an intermediate format glyph packing data, where I take, like so, and I need to know the width and height. I need to know the rest of this stuff here. Right? And so I go like this. I say, all right, I need an array of these things called my packing data array with 129 spots in it. Well, 128, and then I'll get rid of this stupid less than or equal to that I wrote. Right? So there's that, and instead of making a glyph data, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a pointer to a glyph packing data, which will equal packing data plus code point. And the other thing I should do is throw in like exists. Alright, so there's a little multi-line editing for you guys. Let's see. We need width and height. Oh, I need another one of these. Exists. And so these can all go like so. Yep, I'm still just drinking water. You got it right. All right, so yes, it exists. The width is x1 minus x0, and the height is y1 minus y0. And that completely does the whole thing. Now I just gotta figure out how to tell if a code point exists. STBTT get glyph index. Is glyph empty? No. Get code point. Find glyph index. If you're going to perform multiple operations on the same character, call this function with the character you're going to process, then use glyph-based functions instead of the code point-based functions. Yeah, that's the one. I remember talking to Sean about this before. Find glyph index. Font info code point. Not equal to 0. So that gives me an array of glyphs. Uh-oh. Who screwed things up? What's What is this? What is this? Oh, I know what's happening. There we go. So that was a parser bug. It happens when I do multi-line editing sometimes, which means I've got to research a better way to do the... By research, I mean rewrite the thing that's broken. But I gotta rewrite the, the relaxer for that. Okay. So now, find a glyph index. Yeah. Okay. I'm pretty sure that that looks good. So now, I think what I want to do is, well, there's a couple options. I could use the get version that'll just allocate a different chunk for every glyph and just store those in the packing data and then use that to rasterize myself into the final packed version. But I want to see the make code point bitmap arguments real quick. Here's the output, out with outstride, right, so I can give you an outstride. That's good. Scale X, scale Y. Good point, and so on. Now, I believe what I want to do is I want to include packing width, packing height as a separate thing, or like pack width, pack height. And the reason I want that is because when I'm packing this, I'm going to want to leave a little room around the edge. Everything still works. Okay. Yeah, so lastly, I think I'll go ahead and go with, I'll go with that. Right, so we'll pack it by, or we'll render these by using the make code point bitmap version and using an output and a stride. Now, comes a kind of interesting thing. How do you pack rectangles? This sounds like the kind of thing that's like a probably not in P. You know what I mean? It's probably not in P. In fact, it's so similar to a tiling problem, you could even be worried that there might be like it might be butting up on, it might be bordering on an incomputable problem, but obviously it's not. I mean, it's possible to find a packing for the rectangles, but with yeah, it's very similar to tiling, so you're getting very close to a set of things that are crazy difficult. So let's just jump right in and do all right, I was trying to decide how crazy I wanted to go on this, because the best idea that I have is to sort them based on their height, and then start with the tallest one and put it in the top left corner, and then try to add them in such a way that you keep it perfectly squarular all the way through, and each row would be have a max height based on its leftmost. You would always add things from left to right, and then each row has its tallest thing all the way to the left. And that defines the height of that row. And then you at each point decide, do I add this to the right-hand side or below on a new line of or like do I add which row basically do I add this to? And since they're sorted on height, you can always add them to any row. It'll never be longer than the previous one or longer than the ones that have already been placed. And so you just try to decide which one can I add this to that will keep us closest to a square. And if none of those will work, you then pop it down in the bottom. And I'm trying to decide, I was trying to decide whether to do that because it sounds like a lot of fun and sounds awesome, or to just do the dumbest possible thing. And I decided to do the thing that sounds awesome. So, sort. First thing I need is, I made this list of 128 things. Some of them exist, some of them don't. I need, I see what I need. So we're gonna do, rect packing. We'll just call this packing rectangle. Rect 128 of those in 32 T. Rect count equals 0. Packing rectangle. In 32T width height, uint width height will be the input values. It'll also have a uint 32T user I or like user or I, and that will link it back up to whatever it represents. So I have the width and height of each rectangle. And I need output values, so that's x0, y0, x1, y1, right? Okay, cool. So now what we're gonna add is void sort rex by h which will go, I need some packing rectangles, I need the start point and the max point on the range you want me to sort. And then if start plus one is less than max, in other words, if there's at least two things to sort, then go ahead and go ahead and take these recs, this start and this max, return to me a midpoint, and then I will sort the recs by age again, recursively, in the areas that you weren't able to finish, right? Which is everything except for mid, right? So everything from mid, start to mid plus minus one, and then mid plus one to max, I'll sort all of those again. Alright, but you just go ahead and get that index in the right position, and here we go. Sort rex by age partition. Here's the packing rectangle rex. There's the start. There's the max. Pivot will equal max minus one. We're eventually going to return start. And then what we do is for, we have an I that starts at start. It goes to pivot. Plus plus I, and by start less than I pivot, I meant I less than pivot. If rex I dot h is less than rex pivot dot h, then we go ahead and we rect swap. We'll do that this way. Rect swap rex I with rect start, right? And we don't plus plus here because that's going to be a macro and it'll apply multiple times. So there we go. And then finally, at the very end, we swap the pivot in there. Now this is going to be the same all the way through, so let's just pull that out and call it big H, right? Int 32 big H equals that. I don't like using big variables willy-nilly, so let's call that H pivot. Let's call that pivot h. Alright, so we go across each one, each step of the way, we check the pivot against the current thing. If we think that the current thing is smaller than the pivot's height, we go ahead and say this needs to go before the pivot, we swap it to wherever start is, an advanced start, which blah blah blah, return start, very good, and we need to write rect swap. Now what rect swap will do is it'll take A and B, and it will say, look, A and B, here's the thing. I need to swap some stuff, but I don't care about these four things here. They are unimportant. So just swap your width, height, and your eyes for me, please. And then so it goes like this. While 0, uint32t temp will go right there. And then we'll do something like, let's space this out, right? All right. So t will equal a dot width. A dot width will equal b dot width. B dot width will equal t. New line. So we can go ahead and take those and push them over here. And the same thing will happen all the way through. So here we have height, here we have I, and there we go. We've swapped A and B in all of the relevant ways, because remember, these are output, so we don't really care about sorting them. They're not relevant. Okay. So there we can sort them. See if that builds. Ewing 32T is not a thing. Type def struct is supposed to be a struct, sorry. Signed, unsigned mismatch. My bad. Int 3? That's not going to do me any good. I need at least 32 bits. Thanks for the warning. Let's see. Okay, it's not going to be unreferenced for long, buddy boy. You just wait and see. So, as we're going, what we're going to do is take each rect, and the rect count will go up. And we will get a pointer to the, we'll call that rectangles, actually. And then this will become the rect. There we go. If, no, rect, packing rectangle, rect, we'll start off at 0, and that just turns into width equals glyph width, height equals glyph height, and I equals the code point. Alright, so generate all that stuff. Alright, so then what I want to do is, once that's done, we've got our rectangle data. Let's go ahead and sort rects by H. Here are the rectangles, there's the beginning, and there's the count of all of the rectangles. Okay, so now they're sorted by H. Now what we want to do is we want to establish... okay, so during the packing thing, there's going to be a maximum number of rows, which will be based on 128. Now what I should do first is go ahead and canonicalize that. So max code point 128. There we go. Now I can come up here again and say, look, we're going to need a packing row. This will be called a row, and I'll have max code point of these, right? And each row, well, let's go define what that means. Packing row. Each row has an X position and a Y position. Right? And so row count equals 0. There we go. And what we're going to do now is pack rectangles. Here are the rectangles. Here's the rect count. And here are the rows, right? And that comes up here. So, we have some packing rectangles. We have a count, which is the number of rows, or the number of rectangles we have, and we get the packing rows come in right here. There's the rows, and we're just going to assume that the number of rows is allocated to be large enough, and in this case it has been, so we're good. Right. So I need row count. Start at 0. Max x to start at 0, and max y will start at 0. Max y is a slightly redundant variable, but I think it'll make things cleaner. Okay, and so what we do is we say, all right, for int 32, I equals 0, I is less than count, plus plus I. That's always fun to write. We take packing rectangle rect, which is just rectangles plus I. Yeah. And we then decide whether or not to insert it into a new row or to place it into an existing row. So that will be something like best row I equals 0 in 32t best row x equals 0 so then what we do is we say, all right, best row I equals negative 1. Best row X equals OX FFFFFFFF 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Or better yet, there we go. And so negative 1 and tilde 0. That's what we initialize to. All right, so we do int 32 j equals 0 j. Let's put I and j up here. Let's make this really nice. I always like doing this once in a while. Alright, j less than, you know, I take it back, because every time I do that, I like a lot of it, but too much of it, I eventually get upset with myself later on. I regret it later, so, no, not this time. This time we'll keep it this way. Okay, so we loop across this stuff, the rows, and we say, if I take this row, or rows j dot x, plus the width of my rectangle, that gives me this x. I want this x up here. with this. Right? And then, if this X is better than best row X, then we fix it and we say, aha, this is actually the best row, we were wrong before. Right? So now, when that loop is done, we found the best row we could insert it into. But we have to do one more row, and that's the row that we get if we insert below. Right? And basically the idea is we don't increase the height if we do that. If we insert below, we increase the height. So what we want to do now is say, alright, just a thought. Hard to explain right now, but just a thought. Okay, so, we want to make the move that will minimize the difference between the width and height of the packed version. So, I need to compute this y. This y would be max y plus my rectangle's height, right? And then, or this is like worst y, right? And that hangs out up here. So the worst y I could do is this. And I want to decide, is the worst y better than my best x? If so, I do y. Otherwise, I do x. And the way I determine that is I go... y diff equals... worst y greater than best row x question mark, then it's worst y minus best row x, else it's best row x minus worst y, right? And x diff is max y greater than question mark, or that should be max x. Basically, we take what's going to be the final position. So if I make the y choice, I can predict if I were to do y that the new height would be the value worst y, and the max x would still be the same. Technically, that might not be true. So let's account for that. Right, so what'll happen is this is new row y, new row x equals max x greater than rect width, question mark, max x else rect width, right? So here's the new row x, here's the new row y. The x we get if we're on a new row, the y we get if we're on a new row, and then we do new row x new row y. There we go. So if we choose the y option, that's the difference between x and y. If we choose the, and what I should do here is be like absolute difference between a and b is a greater than b, question mark, a minus b, else b minus a. Then I can take all this and replace it with abs diff. And similarly, we can take this and go, all right, here we would not change the y, and we would change the, we would keep the, we would change the x by adding something in. Now, the first time through, the first iteration, an item, its best row x will be infinity, basically. So it'll compare these two and go, oh, the new row x versus new row y is some finite thing, whereas this is like as large as it possibly can be. It'll have to pick this one, right? After that, whether or not it picks this or that will be very much based on the shapes that come in. So, if ydiff is less than xdiff, we add a new row. So let's do xdiff less than ydiff first, actually. So if xdiff is less than ydiff, then I take rows dot best row I dot x, and that is my rect x0. My rect y0 is this thing's y, and then I take both of those, and then if I rect x0, turn that into a y, get rid of those, whoops, right, and then something like plus rect width, except in this case it's height. Alright, good. Any idea? And then I need to update the rows X. Yeah. Otherwise, else, max X, max Y. Right, so wait a minute. After doing this, I should say if this is greater than max X now equals this, right? Else, we have to make a new row. So the new row means that we take row let's see, x0 equals 0, y0 equals rows row count minus 1 dot y, no, max y, right? Ah, I see what to do. Row count dot x equals 0 dot y equals max y, and max y plus equals the rex height, and then the rest of that we plus row count, and then if I do best row I equals row count right there, then all this, so this can just always happen. Yeah, and then this is if x diff is greater than, or if y diff is less than x diff, right? So if the y one is actually smaller, then we will grow that way, because that way will lead to a smaller perimeter, and we're assuming that if we fit it into a square we'll do an alright job. Could be a really dumb assumption, but basically what this does is minimize the perimeter, which has the nice side effect that it keeps the dimensions small, so even though the area might not be great, it'll have a lower chance of blowing out, like, the device caps. Since that's what this is kind of trying to minimize on. Yeah, and I guess this basically operates under the assumption that the heights are all fairly similar across the font, that we're not dealing with huge height differences, because then you'd definitely have corner cases in here that would have big problems. But for the most part, I think it's good. That assigned an x0, y0, x1, y1 to every single rectangle. And it has the added bonus that at the end we know the max x, max y. So how about we return those? Okay, so that's assigned a location to each rectangle, and it's given us a max x, max y. So let's go get that. Down here, we'll call this atlas width, atlas height. So now, in theory, we've packed these rectangles, and what I would like to do now is loop over the rectangles. And just find out where each one went. So, printf %d rect %d We'll do it this way. X0, Y0. This should be unsigned. X1, Y1. I, you, what is that? That's, I need the rectangles. No, rect X0. Y0, replace zeros with ones, and the rect equals the rectangles plus the I. Why would you give me a conversion error on that? Just interpret that as the right thing if you're worried about it. I don't get it. Uint 32, y diff, x diff. There we go. Let's take a look. Uh-oh. So yeah, it looks like about the right number of glyphs, but their positions seem a little bit wild. So the first one is positioned at 00, 42949678286 0. That sounds like it took the wrong branch. So if ydiff is less than xdiff, max y should be 0 and best row x should be gigantic. I can't really trust that this thing is actually doing what I expect, so here's what I'm going to do. Okay, so still messed up. Let me say after each step, let me printf made new row, or and let's do that this way, added to row bottom. Strange Zach, Cipher Drive is not pure C, no. I just wanted to make the TTF to bitmap thing in pure C, because I was in a mood when I started it, and I'm still in that mood. To row %d. Best row I. Yep. Printf. Max x, max y. Those are going to be unsigned. Writing in pure C is not really any different from writing in C++ for me, like, the experience of it. It feels like the same thing. The only difference is that I have to type def every struct. That's, like, the one thing that's notably different. I don't take advantage of the fact that void pointers cast easily. I always manually cast them anyway. I mean, I like the concept of the autocast, I just don't use it, because almost invariably I'm going to have to compile it into C++ code eventually. I like the concept of the, like, return a void pointer and assign it to any kind of pointer. But I feel like C++ should have allowed returns of void pointers to continue to do that. Just 'cause. So it says it made a new row. But then why would it go and say this? Like, max y should have incremented by the rectangle's height. And you know what I should see? I should see printf rect percent %d equals percent %u percent %u I rect width rect height. Are these fucked? Because if my input widths and heights are fucked, that would explain it. Yeah, they do look to be totally wrong. Why is that happening? So width, where's that? Width equals printf. Let's see, x1 and y1, or x1 and y x0. X0 minus percent %d minus percent %d equals percent %d new line. X1 minus x0 equals x1 minus x0. Here it is. Negative 10 minus 0 is negative 10. Wait, x0 minus x1. That's not what I wrote. I wrote x1 minus x0. Negative 10 and 0. Did I put the x's and y's in the wrong order? Get code point bitmap box. So I input the scale x0, y0, x1, y1. Hey. I mean, those look wrong because they're all zeros. I shouldn't see multiple zeros in a row. That doesn't make any sense. Unless these are like really wide characters. That adds 10, that adds 10, that adds 10, that adds 10 too. So, each one of those decided to add a new row, and they're so thin that they're all a height of 10. Each one decides to add a new row, even though, like, this one could have just put itself right here. You're right. I'm really bad at that. By the way, we've been using 4Coder 4011 all day. I thought there might be an issue with it because of all the changes, but it's actually looking pretty solid, so we might not be too far away from a release after all. All right. Okay, so yes, it looks to me like the those are coming out quickly. I'm gonna go take out some of this. That's so cool. Okay, try that again. All right, so yeah, that there doesn't make any sense. They should be all lined up in a row, but they're not. Even though these here, what? I sorted these from smallest to largest. Oops. Okay. These need to be sorted in the order that I'm not used to sorting them in. Okay, so it added an there's a 0 by 0 1. I've made a couple mistakes. Okay, so empty. So here's the deal. First of all, before while I'm generating these need to be using the pack width and the pack height. And before that, if glyph width equals 0 or glyph height equals 0, then glyph empty equals true, else we can do that. Still not sure what the deal is there, but let's see. So the first thing I got placed at 0, 0. And it went down 17 and over 4. The next one got placed to the left of that one, which makes sense. It got placed at 4, 0, and so it went down 16 and to the right 5. Then this one got placed to the right of those because that would lead to 16, 16, and a tie goes to the x direction, not to the well, presumably, since it was a tie in the x direction, moving in down in the y direction wouldn't be good. So here it made a perfect 16 by 16 square with my first three images, with just the small issue that there's 17th pixel on, this image. So it's actually 17 by 16. But the point is, it's over 16, down 17. It goes ahead and decides that it's going to add another one there, because if it goes down, it's going to get much larger by 16 points. But if it goes right, it gets not as it gets larger by a smaller amount. So it goes to the right again. But then it finally decides, you know what? We're going to have to go down. So it goes down 17, and puts one at zero over at zero. After that, it keeps extending from that. That went out very quickly because that was had a width of 15, so it went out 15 right away. This one followed suit, and looks like they're adding 15 in their height each. So that had a height of 15. This has a height of 15. That reached 28, so it drops down again because 28 is pretty far to the right. So if it adds there or there, yeah. Okay, well, let's go up another step. Tracking this in my head's getting hard. I haven't added IntoBot as an editor, if you didn't know that. Okay, so we made a new row, and now it's 4 by 17. Then we added to row 0, and now it's 9 by 17. Then we added to row 0, and it's 16 by 17. Then we added to row 0, and it's 22 by 17. Then we made a new row, so now it's 22 by 32. Then we added to row 1. So it's 28 by 32. Then we added to row 0, so it's still 28 by 32. Didn't grow that time. Then it's added to row 0, so the height doesn't change, but that grows out by another 10 from where it was. It was presumably at 27, now it's at 37. I see, cool. So this one, let's see. Got added to row 1. And the size is now 38 by 32. Then it made a new row. And the size is 38 by 46, so when it added the new row, that went up by 8. Ah, because they're wrecked. Wait, that went up by... Oh, 14, I see. That went up by more than 8. That went up by 14. That makes sense. So that put that right there. Now I should have row 0, 1, and 2, but then this made a new row 2. Why did it stop adding to existing rows? These could have easily gone on the same row, but now it's just adding to a new row over and over again, and that doesn't make any sense. Okay, so let's say at each step, I'm getting lots of good information out already. Let's get a little more, and let's put two new lines between each one, because it's going to get crazy now. So there's my rectangle. Then I've got my y diff equals this, and my x diff equals this. So y diff of 13, x diff of that much. So it picks x diff, it adds to a new row. X diff of 1, so it adds to a new row. I see. So x diff is 8 here. Why? Why did it go from 8 to 1? Shouldn't it have gotten larger? I added to a new row. Why would it get smaller and then larger? So This is 9 by 17. This is 16 by 17. Ah, and then it went starting to outgrow. So I see. So here, growing in the X direction actually made us more square-like. So it picked that. Growing in that direction again, we push past that, and now we're on the other side of that absolute value V. Very well. Then we have a 15 by 15 rectangle come in, and it decides it needs to make a new row, because if it pushes this way again, the x diff will be 20. Because that'll end up being 42. Or, no, that'll end up being 37. There it is. That'll become 37. So then the difference would be 20. So it says, alright, but if I go down, then I'm going to just get a 32 on the bottom, which is a difference of 10. So it picks the y difference and makes a new row. Then it goes ahead and says, alright, I could add to row 0 or to row 1. It adds to row 1 because it's, let's see, at row 0 we had a width of 22. On row 1 we have a width of 15. So, I see the bug. So best row X I can't actually ever become less than the max x. I've already grown to the size of max x, so even if I add this to this row and it doesn't overflow the max x, I shouldn't say that the x will width will then be less than the max x. So I have to say it's at least max x in size. There we go. So now, yeah, it's quite erratic where these things end up at the end, which is what I was expecting. And it ends up with a size of 107 by 111. So the average area that each of these rectangles takes up is 127. Well, the largest rectangle let's see, 4 by 17 is pretty big. That's about 40, though. No, it's about 80. It's a little less than 80. 15 by 15 is pretty big. That's about 50 plus another 50 is 200. So that's much bigger than that 127 value. But that can't be. Yeah, that's something like 200. That's right. So as those approach 20, that would approach 400. 13 by 13 is 16, is 169. right? So, yeah, that could easily be over 200. What about something like that right there? 32, 64, getting close to 100, 140. Yeah, that's actually not that wrong. 140, 60, 84, 80. Forty, 96, 130. Wow. So that means that it was very efficient if it. Okay, so now I want to see if I believe that this actually worked. There's a few ways I can check it. So first of all, I'm going to check it for correctness. And the way we can check for correctness is that if no two rectangles overlap, then it's correct. And if they all fit inside of the bigger one. Let's start by tracking down and getting rid of all of these printfs that we don't need anymore. Insofar as wants to see what the texture looks like, and I concur that is a point of great interest. Okay. What could we do? I could just finish up and try to generate the texture and then see if it looks right. Here's what we can do. So I have this coming in. Let's make a temporary let's take a temporary moment to or image. Let's go ahead and use that void pointer thing we were talking about. Atlas height times atlas width. Mem set image 0 atlas size I gotta check something. Okay, yep, it's spelled correctly. Clear it to 0, and then for int32t I equals 0, I is less than rect count plus plus I. Rect equals rectangles plus I. Let's see, then we need line. Let's see, we're going to have int32 stride is going to be the atlas width. So our line begins at image plus rect x0 plus rect y0 times the stride, right? And then for int32, y equals 0, y is less than rect height plus plus y. At the end of each, we do line plus equals stride for int32, and we do pixel equals the line x equals 0, x is less than rect width plus plus x, pixel equals OXFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFFF Right now, what I could do is just open a extra file, fopen test bump write binary. I'm going to switch over to my bitmap magic folder, which is where I keep pre-made bitmap wrangling stuff. Okay. There we go. Bitmap magic. Gonna have to just type def these real quick. Gonna have to replace i32 with int32t. Oh, better idea. Better idea. Type def int. These type defs must be up here. Yeah. Oh, why am I doing C standard int? That's C++. There you go. Boom. There we go. Oh, I see. I see. So this one, load info. So this one doesn't care about the info. This one. From name with info. No, I don't need bitmap loading, actually. So, why don't we skip that for now? That doesn't make any sense. Maybe it's been a Relex problem again. File save. by name. This info. UN32, so the iterations using unsigned ints. Alright, so I have my test file. And now, bump file save allows me to just pass in a bump data. So let me get one of those. And test bump data. Okay, so bump width equals the atlas width, height byte pitch 32 image. That's not going to cast quite right. Alright. Now in theory it should, and let me F close my test. Now in theory it should create a bitmap which Windows Explorer can render for me. Test bump. Ooh, it's not rendering for me. It's big, but it doesn't like it. Java and Python both suck ass. I've never used them enough to know the difference. Let's see. Bump file save. Yeah, I enjoy some C++ programming. I could. Oh, does STB image have a. Or is there an STB image version for this? My file save used to work for me. I'm wondering what's going wrong here. Byte pitch. Oh! That's in bytes. There we go. Now the black parts are not filled, and the white parts are wrecked. What? It's bullshit. My rectangular right isn't quite correct. Oh, I need to increase the pixel pointer for one thing. Everything you're looking at is, this is a C file on the left, and this on the right is a C++ file. and Forcoder is written in C++, the application that I'm using. Okay, so let's see. This is where I'm drawing out my rectangle. I start at rect x0, y0 times the stride. Here I increase by the stride, which means I end up down one line from where I started, and then I start with x0 and I go across the width. At each step, I write out a thing you do. The thing you do, you do. Run that again. Hey, there we go. This is upside down. 1 minute. That didn't work. I thought negative h meant that it was upside down. Oh well. Maybe I'm using that for math and I'm too dumb to make that work. That's okay. We can do this another way. Whenever I want to move somewhere, I subtract the stride. And when I'm picking my original line, I need to do atlas width minus one. Actually, I've changed my mind again. I don't want it to be white. I'm not sure which one of those counts as the alpha channel. I think it's the first one. Let's call this red. Green. And blue. And when I go to do that, I'll write out my color. And my color will be colors I modulo 3. Run that again. Why is there a little bit of black at the top? That's definitely, see right there, that's the tallest one. Why is that there? Cryzy92 asked if I needed to consider little endian, big endian type stuff, and the answer is, not really, because the way programming usually works, like the way a programming language works, is you write your number from big to small and then it puts it down into memory the correct way. Like, you don't have to write this to mean 10 on a little endian something or big endian, right? You always write the thing the way you think about it. The only exceptions that kind of get in there is like Windows colors are flipped and stuff like that you gotta be aware of. But in this particular case, the way Windows set it up was so that it would look natural if you did it in the sort of natural written way, rather than the natural memory order. So the memory order is backwards, but Windows makes writing it correct, I guess is what I should say. Oh, good point insofar as that is a good Twitter avatar. That's a very good Twitter avatar. Now, there are some mysteries. Some mysteriousness happening here. I think that my shift is off. I think I'm doing something wrong with my finding the line still, because this is all fucked. So, presumably I want to be able to write to position 0. Rect y 0 can't be greater than atlas width. Can only be smaller. Can be 0. Why? Something. 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 For instance, if we're at 0, then the position I want is atlas width minus 1. Oh, that should be atlas height. I'm an ass. Okay. I didn't fix anything. Did I not run it yet? There we go. All right, cool. So this is it. There's some concerning stuff like this rectangle right here. What's it doing over here? Why is it intruding on little red guy's space? That doesn't seem right. That seems rude. Ugh. One second. There. There. Okay. This drunk Dane, this is debug art. It's debug art, not structured art, because this is like a debug visualization. Okay. But that's an underscore, but that's a period, but that is a pipe. Could totally be wrong, but just guesses here. Be really interesting to see which character is which now. 1 minute. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, that right there seems wrong. I can't shake that feeling. So this is generally right, but I want to run a more extensive double-checking test to make sure that a few things are not going wrong here. So first of all, let me make sure the sort actually worked. Ah, my sort is bugged. Okay. Let's read this over carefully. So we're sorting from start to max. We say if start plus 1 is less than max, and the reason we say that is if I get, like, for instance, a 0 here and a 1 here, or a 0 and a 0, in both of those cases, this is already sorted. But if I get, like, a 0 here and a 2 here, I have two items. So now I do need to figure out which one is bigger. dot width equals a dot width equals b dot width. That swap seems good. So I grab a pivot, say I is equal to start. I has to remain less than the pivot all the way through. If, then I plus plus the start. I've written this so many times that I have a hard time. Alright, I'm like having a hard time thinking of what kind of bugs there are, because I don't normally get bugs when I try to write quicksort. So I'm not sure what to look for. I has to be less than pivot, because we don't compare pivot to itself and swap it or anything. We swap it down there to the start position. I always make that mistake. Mid minus 1 is wrong, because my sort here treats that as max, which means 1 greater than the end. So I want to go from start to mid, because mid doesn't actually get included. Then I don't need to sort mid, but I go from mid plus 1 to max. I do always make that bug, and I always forget it. Alright. There we go. Let's try this again. Oh, it updated automatically. It seems to be... I mean, I don't see the same problem we had from before. I wonder what the density is what I want to know. So, let's see. You're gone. I think we're working now, but I want to see... So it's a little guesswork for me when I'm doing the formatting. Oh, that's not how I want it to look. Cool. 80% efficiency. I'm curious now about how good that can be, but now's not the time. Or is it? I don't know. I'd have to take a look and obsess about it for a little while. I think this is good enough. This is one of those good enough situations, but while it's good enough, while it's being good enough, I think I'm going to go ahead and just think about it for a little while. Because if you adopted the policy that alternating rows, one row does everything on top and the next row does everything on its bottom, right? So if the second row here did aligned along the bottom and the next row aligned along the top and bottom, right? You could line those up in such a way that you'd have a nice big black space right there that could easily fit some of these last things in there, right? You could be like, insofar as has a good idea, time to write a neural network solver. So what we're going to need is we're going to need a couple of GPU powered, maybe some like I don't know, high end NVIDIA cards or I don't know what's the most high end GPU we've got. I'm gonna need somebody to buy a license for MATLAB because that's the easiest way to handle those situations with the neural networks and the. Why isn't that block underneath right here? All right. So insofar as is in charge of the hardware situation. Now, I hope there isn't already academic research in this field, because I would certainly like to be the progenitor of said research, if possible. Why wouldn't it put that underneath? It's because it doesn't know. It's trying to maintain a square, so it put that right there, because putting it underneath was going to be making a big difference this way compared to what it had. But if it had done that, then we could shrink this all the way down to there. We don't want any one row to get big in excess of other rows. And why didn't those just go along these edges here, now that I'm thinking about it? Why didn't that just go right there? Why didn't that just go right there, right? And all of those should have ended up here. Alright, well, that's what we did today. We worked on rectangle packing, and I made some a new Twitter avatar, and got some STB font extraction stuff figured out. I'll need to do a little bit more of it some other time, but I feel like for a chill stream, this has been long enough, and I'm happy with the with the results. So thanks everybody for joining in, and I'll see you guys around later. Bye bye.